Thank you. Good morning and welcome, friends. We're so glad that you have chosen to join us here on our online worship service at Kingwood Christian Church. Here at Kingwood Christian, we seek to follow Jesus in offering extravagant welcome to anyone who would like to gather and follow Jesus with us. And so no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. No matter your age or the color of your skin, you are welcome here. No matter your marital status or sexual orientation, you are welcome here. No matter your abilities or special needs, you are welcome here. No matter your gender identity or citizenship or immigration status, you are welcome here. No matter your emotional state, zip code, level of education, affluence, or power, you are welcome here. If you believe some of the time, none of the time, or all of the time, you are welcome here. Come, friends, let's gather around the table of Jesus, for you are welcome here.
Welcome to worship at Kingwood Christian Church. We seek to be an open and inclusive community of faith that is learning and practicing the teachings of Jesus. During this time of difficulty, as a church, we want to support you and your families. And so we are focusing on the story of Joseph as a role model for how to have confidence in crisis. Whether you are a longtime member, a newer addition to our faith community, or a guest, we extend open arms to you to come and join us as we seek and find this one who has promised to be a very present help in time of trouble. Welcome. We are in the midst of a health crisis as a deadly disease runs rampant through our communities. As Easter people, followers of the risen Christ, how will we respond during this time of adversity? We will do what anyone would do who is completely confident that God is with us. We are in the midst of an economic crisis as millions have lost their jobs. We have no idea how long the shutdown will last. As Easter people, followers of the risen Christ, how will we respond during this time of adversity? We will do what anyone would do who is completely confident that God is with us. We are in the midst of a social crisis as we live in isolation from one another, missing the touch and companionship of family, friends, and Christian community. As Easter people, followers of the risen Christ, how will we respond during this time of adversity? We will do what anyone would do who is completely confident that God is with us. We are not the first to experience such affliction. Our spiritual ancestors endured disease, poverty, loneliness, and persecution. We walk in their footsteps. As Easter people, followers of the risen Christ, how will we respond during this time of adversity? We will do what anyone would do who is completely confident that God is with us.
This is Great is Thy Faithfulness. We'll be singing all three verses.
This morning, as we move into our time of prayer, I want to offer a really beautiful prayer that I came upon this past week. It's authored by Teresa of Avila, and it's a prayer for peace that has much to say to us during this time. Would you pray with me? Loving God, we claim the words of Saint Teresa of Avila, who prayed that may today there be peace within. May you trust God that you are exactly where you are meant to be and you are not alone. May you not forget the infinite hope and possibilities that are born of faith. May you use the gifts that you have received and pass on the love that has been given to you. May you be content knowing you are a child of God, letting God's presence settle into your bones and allowing your soul the freedom to sing and dance, praise and love in all circumstances. This peace is there for each and every one of us today and forever. And now let us all gather together in praying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, guys. Welcome to Children's Moment this week. This week, we're going to be talking about Genesis 41. Genesis 41, the main three characters are Joseph, Pharaoh, and the baker. Now, this story takes place 2 years after the last time we met last week. Now, 2 years after the last time we met, the Pharaoh, who's basically a king, had a dream about seven cows. Seven really healthy and big cows, and then seven kind of skinny and not so good cows. Now, in his dream, he had the seven really nice cows next to a river. Now, the seven sick and kind of skinny cows came up next to him and ate all the big cows, and they stayed skinny. Then the Pharaoh woke up and realized everything was a dream. The next night he had a dream, and he had seven ears of wheat, which were plump and good and looked good. And then after that, he had 7 years of bear swallowed up. He had seven withered by the east wind, and they just looked bad, and they were gross and not as good as the other ones. Well, these seven ate the good ones and swallowed them up and just left the bad ones. This made the Pharaoh worried because he didn't know what it meant. He was so confused by his dreams, and he ended up talking to someone. When he brought this up, his chief baker went, "Oh, I know a guy. I know a guy named Joseph. Joseph was in prison with me, and I had a dream a long time ago, and he told me what the dream meant, and it came true." Now, this really got the Pharaoh's attention, and he decided to have someone go get Joseph out of prison and come interpret his dreams. Now, when Joseph met the king, Joseph said, and heard his dreams, he was like, "Your dreams are the same. They mean the same thing." And the Pharaoh was confused by this. He goes, What does that mean?" And he said, "God is saying that you'll have seven good years of healthy stuff for Egypt, and then you will have seven bad things right after that. 7 years of bad things. Now, no one will remember the good years. They will only remember the bad." The Pharaoh then was very happy with him and said, "Thank you." And was like, "Will you help me rule the country and be my friend for telling me the truth?" All right, guys. Thank you for coming to thank you for coming to Children's Moment this week. I hope to see y'all next week. All right. Bye.
When was the last time that you rode a roller coaster? Do you remember? I remember when I was a teenager, I just couldn't get enough of that feeling. The thrill of a roller coaster, the feeling, you remember the feeling where your stomach feels like it's up in your throat? For some reason, I really liked that feeling. I'm not really sure why. Well, that is until I rode this roller coaster that you're seeing right now. This is Outlaw Run. It's a roller coaster in Branson, Missouri, and it boasts some of the highest speeds and the biggest twists and turns of any roller coaster in all of the world. It was after I got off of Outlaw Run that I questioned whether I really liked that feeling very much anymore. In fact, I decided that I might not ride roller coasters at all anymore after Outlaw Run. I think I felt sick for like a week after that experience. Well, sometimes life can feel like a roller coaster, can't it? It can feel like it's full of unexpected ups and downs, twists and turns, and some of us are probably feeling like that right now as we make our way through this very present crisis. We're wondering if relief is on the horizon. And today we ask a question, we wrestle with the question of how can our faith help us brave the ups and downs of life and crisis? Well, today we continue on in a teaching series entitled Confidence in Crisis. It's the story of Joseph. And Joseph's story is full of all kinds of ups and downs. It was a roller coaster for sure. And it started on a real high note. Joseph was born the favorite son of a rich man named Jacob. And Jacob decided to give his favorite son this coat of many colors. Joseph also had a dream that somewhere out in the future, that his whole family would bow down to him, that he would become the leader of his family. Now, so everything starts off up here, but then very quickly, it takes a turn. Joseph's brothers, well, they're jealous of him. And they decide that they're going to plot to kill him, but then decide to just sell him to some traders that are on their way to Egypt. But Joseph is resilient. He wins the favor of his new master, Potiphar, and is put in charge of the entire household. Well, that is until Potiphar's wife takes a liking to young Joseph and tries to seduce him. Joseph resists, wanting to honor God with his decisions. Well, that is until Potiphar's wife decides that she's going to tell her husband that it was Joseph that instigated the whole sordid scene. And so Joseph ends up in prison. In prison, in the pit, yet again. Through all the highs and lows, we hear this refrain throughout the scriptures and his story that God, throughout it all, God was with Joseph. Now, there's a term that's used in each of those refrains. It's a beautiful term. It's called hesed. Now, hesed means a resilient loyalty. Throughout it all, God was resilient in loyalty to Joseph. Throughout it all. I almost kind of think of that term hesed. It's almost like those safety restraints that come down when you're about to ride a roller coaster. You know what I'm talking about? Those safety restraints that kind of like clamp down. They're not very comfortable. But then you can kind of hang on and have this sense that no matter what's to come, all the craziness and the chaos that will ensue, that at least I'm going to be safe. At least I'm going to be secure. See, this is what this term hesed, it whispers to us. You're going to be okay. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be loyal to you throughout. God's love is fiercely loyal to us. Well, in the 13 years that follow, Joseph stays in prison. And he stays there clinging to a dream. That dream that he had back when he was 17 years old, when he was back with his family. It was a dream that God had something special in store for Joseph. That God had placed some kind of a calling upon his life. That no matter the circumstances, that he could hang on to it. And that's that image, the kind of a white knuckling of hanging on no matter what. That's what dreams do, right? They keep us hanging on no matter how much what our experience is incongruent with God's dream. How God's dream looks a certain way and how our reality outside the window looks a completely different way. God's dream is full of hope and opportunity and healing and justice and compassion. While our present reality, as we look outside our window, as we look on the TV screen, it's full of uncertainty. It's full of fear. It's full of even corruption and sadness and suffering. And so we wait. We cling to the dream of God. See, dreams play a major role in the Scriptures. You might know this if you're a reader of the Scriptures. Dreams play a different role than they do in our present context. Oftentimes, we use dreams to psychoanalyze the past. This is something that was introduced to us by Freud. But dreams in the Scriptures play a very, very different role. They represent an inbreaking of God into history, where God's mysterious movement and activity and presence is revealed to us in a new way that's not easily seen. It points us also towards the future. Let me give you just a few examples of how this happens in the Scriptures, and especially this story. Let's talk about it in the context of Joseph's story. The Scriptures, they reveal how dreams reveal insight about God's sovereignty, about how God is ruling over history. And ours is a God with that kind of power and that kind of ability. Even when God decides to use the seduction plot, the seduction scheme of Potiphar's wife, to move Joseph towards a desired end, which is an audience with Pharaoh. For that audience would open a door to where provision and blessing could be given to the people throughout the coming famine. It's messy, but it's effective. You see, God uses all kinds of different circumstances for good purposes. Here's another example. In the Scriptures, dreams reveal God's perspective and God's way. See, undeniably, as we look at this story, God decides to extend care and partnership to the Egyptian people. It is through the Egyptians that God's blessing and care is extended to the rest of the known world at that time. Sometimes we have this idea that God's care and concern is only for the Hebrews. But we're expanded by this dream scenario of Joseph to see how God's love and concern is for and with all people. There's one more example I'll share with you. God, in the Scriptures, dreams reveal a bigger ongoing story. We're let in, we're introduced to a greater meta-narrative that is playing out behind all of the subplots here in this life, that God's story is over the top, the meta-narrative beyond and above. And in this meta-narrative, we see that God cares about the troubles of this world, that God does not stand aloof in this story, but that God is very much intimately involved, intervening to heal and to guide history. Even the great Pharaoh and all of his power just plays his part in the grand story of God. I would say the same thing of any president, President Trump or President Obama before him. They play a prominent role, but just one role nonetheless in the greater story of God. I want to invite you to join me in Genesis chapter 41. Pharaoh has a dream, and no one can interpret this dream for Pharaoh. Well, that is until Pharaoh's cupbearer remembers when he was back in the joint, when he was back in prison, and he remembers a guy who interpreted a dream for him one time, and it came to be true just as he said. His name was Joseph. And so the cupbearer decides to gain audience with Pharaoh. And he says, I know a guy back from when I was in prison, and I think he can help you out, Pharaoh. And so Joseph, Joseph is cleaned up and shaved. He's given new clothes and he is presented before Pharaoh. And this is how their interaction proceeds. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I have had a dream, and there is no one who can interpret it. I have heard it said that of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it." Joseph answered Pharaoh, "It is not I. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer." I love how that passage begins. Pharaoh's addressing Joseph, and he says, "I have heard of you that you can interpret this dream, that you can give me what I want." And Joseph abruptly says, "No, it is not I. I cannot help you. I do not have the wisdom that you speak, but God does. God is the one who can give you the answers to your dreams." You see, there's a major transformation that takes place in the waiting period. For there's a major difference in the man that we see, the young man at 17, Joseph, and now the man that is at 30 years old, who stands before Pharaoh, who proclaims loud and clear that this story is not about me, that I'm just playing my part in a much bigger story, in a dream that God has for me in my life, as he serves the greater dream of God. Let's go into the rest of the story. Starting off there in verse 17. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "In my dream, I was standing on the banks of the Nile. Seven cows, fat and sleek, came up out of the Nile and fed on the reed grass. Then seven other cows came up after them, poor, very ugly and thin. Never had I seen such ugly ones in all the land of Egypt. The thin and ugly cows ate up the first seven fat cows. But when they had eaten them, no one would have known that they had done so, for they were still as ugly as before. Then I awoke. I fell asleep a second time, and I saw in my dream seven ears of grain, full and good, growing on one stalk. The seven ears withered, and seven ears withered and thin, blighted by the eastern wind, sprouted after them, and the thin ears swallowed up the seven good ears. But when I told it to the magicians, there was no one who could explain it to me." Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, "Pharaoh's dreams are one and the same. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The seven good cows are 7 years. The seven good ears are 7 years. The dreams are one. The seven lean and ugly cows are the same that came up after them are 7 years. And the seven empty ears, blighted by the east wind, they are 7 years of famine. It is as I told Pharaoh. God has shown to Pharaoh what he is about to do." Pharaoh's dream starts on the riverbank of the Nile. Now, this is very significant because the Nile plays a pivotal role. It is the life-giving source, not just to Egypt, but to the entirety of the continent below them to the south. The Nile almost takes on this divine role. As long as Egypt and as long as Pharaoh has control of the Nile, as long as the Nile flows, Egypt is secure and strong. But failure of the Nile represents how even Pharaoh, how even Egypt do not hold the keys to life. And in this dream, from the Nile, a famine comes to the region. And without the Nile, the Egyptians' power, it evaporates. And so this dream strikes fear into the heart of Pharaoh. Because no longer will he have this life source. He's reminded yet again that the power is not his to wield, that he is playing only a part in a bigger story. I love in this passage how Joseph is characterized, just a calm, cool character. No bells and whistles in the way that he tells his interpretation. He shares these interpretations plainly with Pharaoh, with simple words, always coming back to that same refrain, and God has revealed to Pharaoh what the future holds. The scene comes to an end in verse 33. Now therefore let Pharaoh select a man who is discerning and wise, and set him over the land of Egypt. Now you kind of have to use your imagination just a bit with this particular part of the scene. See, Joseph doesn't just come with an interpretation, he comes with a plan. And he offers this plan to Pharaoh. He says, and you're going to need someone wise and discerning. Who might that be? Someone to lead the people of Egypt through this time of preparation, through this time of famine that will come in the years that follow. Who might that wise and discerning man be? Now, we don't really know that if Joseph was putting himself forward as that man, but immediately Pharaoh decides to elevate this foreign prisoner and agrees that Joseph should sit at his right hand, that he should administer this entire plan, and the dream continues. You see, I want to back away from the story for just a moment, because the story leads us to a central tenet in the biblical faith. And that is that we are living inside God's resilient dream to bring life and newness despite any circumstance, despite the crisis that we might be experiencing, that God is always working. God is resilient in his dream for life and renewal in all circumstances. We see this in the life of Joseph. We see this in the partnership that God has with the Egyptians. And you know, we also see that Jesus prayed for this in his own ministry on earth. Jesus prayed that this dream would not remain hidden, but that it would be revealed, that it would be actualized in our life. Let me read this passage to you out of Luke chapter 10. Blessed are the eyes that see what you see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings desired to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. You see, Jesus prays in this passage for his disciples, those that would follow him, that their eyes would be open to this dream, that their ears would be open to this dream, that they would be able to locate and actualize this dream, to be a part, to join with God in this dream ongoing. Now let me make just a few suggestions of how that might happen, especially within these times of crisis. God's dream speaks three things to me. The first is that God dreams of healthier people in this time. Many Americans are vulnerable from pre-existing conditions, from their age, from other systemic factors. And yet, more and more experts suggest, and I was reading an article just the other day written by Dr. David Katz, and he was suggesting that our bodies are susceptible and our immune systems are fragile and weakened by the way that we live, by some of the natural rhythms that we follow. And this is more than just the way that we eat and the way that we might not exercise or our activity levels, but it's the way that we work, and it's the rest that we give our bodies. And it's the priorities and the stress levels that we take on. God dreams for us a healthier future, that we would be a healthier people. God also dreams of a simple people. God dreams that this pause would help us clearly see a new set of priorities, that it would help us clearly see and simply embrace a new way of living, a new way of looking at faith and family and relationships, at time and making wise choices, and having a new perspective about money and about things, that we would be a simpler people. This is what God dreams. Finally, God dreams of a hesed people. That beautiful term yet again. God dreams of a church bound together with resilient loyalty and loving kindness that binds us together. May we be for each other like those resilient, loyal arms full of loving kindness. May we be like those arms for each other that will never let go. Amen. And may it be so.
I'd like to invite you now to join with me in reciting together our confession of faith. We confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and proclaim him Lord and Savior of the world. Oh, the goodness of God to send to Egypt a Joseph to supply bread for them in the time of famine, a blessing that would later extend to Joseph's own family. As we come to the table of the Lord this morning, we acknowledge God's glad provision for us through others. We acknowledge those who grew the crops, those who brought in the harvest, the bakers who turned flour into bread, those who made juice from the fruit, the drivers who delivered the goods, and all those working in the stores during this time so that we might have plenty to eat. They are our Josephs. May God use this meal provided for us by the generosity of others to open our eyes to spiritual things. May we see in this ceremony the method God uses to take our dreams for a healthy and whole planet and to help them come true. On the night before Jesus went to be with the Father, he took bread, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body. Whenever you eat of this bread, remember me, see me, for in this element you see the pathway for your dreams to become real." Likewise, he took the cup and he blessed it and he said, "This is my blood that's shed for you. Whenever you drink it, do it in remembrance of me. See me, for in these elements, you have what you need to be partners with God in making dreams come true. Let us pray. Kind Father, we thank you for your goodness to insiders and outsiders alike. We thank you for the story of Joseph that brings new meaning to our table here. Help us to be good stewards of this bread and this cup, that we might be your hands in this world to provide both physical nourishment and spiritual sustenance to our world. We thank you for this glad provision for us, but we are aware that there are others in our communities who are not able to have all that they need right now. We pledge ourselves to help share this bread and this cup with others. In the name of Jesus the Christ, amen. Now in your own homes, we invite you to take the bread and to bless it, to share it, to do this in remembrance of him. Likewise, take the cup in your own home, taking this, drinking it in remembrance of him. Blessings.
There's a quiet place that gives me peace when I'm alone with you. There's a hiding place, your spirit's always there when I'm confused. Only you can purify all this world.
A faith community is like a river formed from many streams of our lives that meet and merge and flow out to the sea. As friends and members of Kingwood Christian Church, we share our time and our energy, our creativity and imagination, our visions and values, our talents, our skills, and our gifts. And the streams of our individual lives merge to create a river that is both deep and broad, made of many streams, and sustaining life, refreshing the land through which it flows. But the river of our community also depends on our shared financial support that makes our visions and our values real. This morning, I invite you to give generously and give joyfully as you are able.
This is the portion of our service where we stop to consider how we may be able to take what we've experienced in worship today and carry it over into our daily lives. So may I ask you a question? What's something that you as an individual or as a family have rediscovered during this time that we've been sheltered in place that you would like to make sure you carry over into your lives moving forward? Pastor Chad invited us to consider how we might simplify our lives. So perhaps there's something that has made your life more simple, more whole because of what you've experienced. So may I encourage you to take a post-it note and write down something that you want to make sure that you continue to practice in the coming days and months. Even better would be if you could chat or text it to us so that we could support you and encourage you in this commitment. Wouldn't it be a shame if the things that we've discovered that have been good that came out of this experience were not carried over into the future? Bless you.
Remember to check our website for announcements this week. Here are four things that are going on. First Fruits, thank you yet again for your response to our food drive. Your generosity is greatly appreciated more than ever. We still have a ground crew request. We need more ground crew volunteers. It's a once a month commitment for 2 to 3 hours. This is a big money saver for the church. Please contact Les King at lesking1803@gmail.com for more information. We also have our need information for our 2020 spring graduates. We're looking for a photo and a small write-up, your school, your degree, your future plans, so we may honor our graduates this May. And if you can send that information to secretary@kwcc.org. Amazon Smiles. If you order through Amazon Smile, smile.amazon.com. Please name Kingwood Christian Church as your charity. And then the church building open date. We're in discussion, but we do not want to rush it and put our congregation in jeopardy. There'll be more updates on that soon.
Please join us as we sing "They'll Know We Are Christians," verse 1.
Merciful and mighty God, we pray for healthier times for our church, for our congregation, and for our communities. Creator God, we also need help setting new priorities and to give us a new perspective on the world around us. Lord God, bind us together with resilient loyalty to you. Amen. Thank you.